the video and audio throughout the session. You have time to interact with the resource person and yesterday's resource person also. So kindly wait your turn and should not interact without permission of the speaker during the session. Here also, after the end of session, we will post the attendance link. So kindly mute your video and audio throughout the session. And don't try to present anywhere during the session. Okay. Munish Kumar, we will start.
Vanakkam. Kumar Aswagar. Morning, Dona Talk present here. We all gather here for the day 4 of the event, 5 days national webinar for this week. Now I call Mr. Aswagar Kumar, Professor, to deliver welcome address and then the interview.
Thank you, Manish. Good morning to you all. Most respected principal of NJAC, Dr. C. Ashok. Most respected heads of the department, Professor Raj Jagannathan and Dr. C. Parameswaran. Distinguished Professor Dr. K. M. Kadreshan. Beloved organizers, Dr. Nyanachandra and Dr. Tirupadi, beloved Professor Dr. Kannan, who is going to deliver vote of thanks today, and today's resource person, Sri Selva Kumar, and my dear participants from all over India. Welcome you all in the fourth day of 5-day national webinar on lecture series, virtual classrooms, and test series for the aspirants of CSIR Mathematical Sciences. It is my bonus to give introduction for our today's resource person. For today's resource person, A. Selva Kumar, scholar, IIT Madras, Chennai. He is an alumni of NJAC and he will be definitely included in our prominent alumni list of NJAC. Sri Selva Kumar did his UG and PG mathematics in NJAC during the respective years 2010-13 and 13-15. Currently, he is doing his PhD research in IIT Madras, Chennai, under the supervision of Dr. Sugas Jaykumar Pandit. His thesis entitled with Open Books and Open Book Embedding of Non-Orientable Three Manifolds. His broad research area of interest are low-dimensional topology and symplectic and contact geometry. Now he is submitted his PhD thesis and waiting for Viva. So far, he published 2 research papers. They were published in reputed indexed research journals in the year 2019, and one paper is in communication. Also, he presented 2 research papers in international conferences. During his PG course, he received MSc scholarship from NBHM, National Board of Higher Mathematics, in the academic year 2014-16. He also qualified GATE exam with rank 184 in the year 2015. He qualified CSIR NET exams 2 times and secured 71th rank in December 2015, and suddenly he secured 10th rank at national level in June 2015. He qualified SET exam in the year 2016. He has given so many talks in IIT Madras campus and also has given invited talks in other than Madras campus, including NJAC, in the area of analysis, topology, geometry, and algebra. Also, he visited IIT Bombay, IISER Pune, NIMS South Korea, IISER Bhopal, Goa University Goa as an invitee. I think we have a eminent and a great scholar in India in our midst. who is going to deliver his speech in continuity and a differentiation topic. Hope the techniques given by will given by our resource person today will helpful to us to face and crack CSIR problems. With this intro, I hand over the session to Sri Selvakumar. Selvakumar, this.
Yes, sir.
Over to you. The platform is yours.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much for my nice introduction. So before starting my session, let me share my screen first.
So can you see my screen? Okay.
Yes, go ahead.
Selvakumar, sir.
Yes, sir.
Unmute your video and audio. So
okay, you want the videos. Are,
yes.
Okay.
Sir. No, sir. We need a video, sir. We need a video.
Video.
What do you mean? We need a video of Selvakumar.
Yes, sir. Selvakumar.
So
we need you, sir.
So actually, I'm using in mobile. So it is saying.
Okay, sir.
It is saying it. You could not on your camera when you are presenting like that. It is fine. So.
Okay.
I think
okay.
I could not on the video.
Okay.
So this is, before starting my session, I just want to thank organizer and all of the faculties in UG and PG Mathematics Department of Anjak and principal and management of Anjak for giving this opportunity to me. And I would like to thank, before that, I just wanted to say about some words about Anjak. So I'm in this position because of Anjak mainly. All the professors have done many things to me. In particular, all the peoples, all the faculty members in our department and as well as other departments also. In particular, I can say my seniors, Saravanan, Arun and Murugan, those are they have done many things to me. So whenever I ask some doubts and all, they will saying answer with smile. Even I have tortured many times, still they won't say anything, and then they just smile and then answer the questions. I should thank this time for all of these things. And I should thank my partners. So I was working with some group of peoples, meaning usually I will solve the questions with some group. So the group is actually containing two members mainly. One is Karthik Babu, another is Kumaran. Without them, I could not be here because actually I am very lazy guy. So they are very active guys. So because of them only, I was involving in mathematics too much. So without them, I could not clear my CSIR exam or something else. So in this situation, I just want to thank both of them also. So I am just saying this because actually, whenever you are writing, you want to be a master in some area, so you have to solve many questions. So if you want to solve many questions, you have to do group discussion. So if you are doing some group discussion, it will be helpful for you anyways. So in the group, somebody may have some different answers. So for a particular question, you may get many answers from the deep groups. So two people have come up with different answer for the same question. So you may get two different answers for the same question. So it will be nice to work with a group. So I will say to the participants that, so if you are join with some group and discuss with those people, that will be very nice. If you are alone, you try to come up with some group who were working for CSIR and all. Even any exam, you have to do that. If you are doing, then it will be nice. So now I will go to the session. So these are some references first. So all the other things are mainly some books with some authors. Those are very nice books. So in particular in linear algebra, Axeller is very good. So in in Tamil Nadu, mainly south side, I mean in Tamil Nadu mostly, we are not using the Oxford book. The Oxford book is actually a very nice book. It will be motivating how the linear algebra goes and all, like to learn the subject, Oxford book is very nice. Also for real analysis, like you must be knowing all the books. I just particularly mentioned Oxford book because actually in Tamil Nadu, most of the people don't know those books actually. That's why the Oxford book title itself, linear algebra by Done Right. So also I just want to mention about the problem book in real analysis. So those three books are very important books. So if you want to do real analysis very well, you have to read that book. Of course, you could not solve all the problem. There is answers also, but you have to read and you have to try to solve. If you could not do, then you can refer the answers. Also, SCAM series book also, every subject, every area in mathematics, there is a SCAM series book. Also, some problem books also. SCAM series books contains many examples, so you can understand the subject more easily. So you can read those books also. In particular, in SCAM series, there is a book called 3000 books, Solved Problems in Linear Algebra. So those books are very nice. So you can ask your library or something, I mean your department library or college library, to buy that book and then read that book. So before mentioning all these books, I should say first your aim is to solve questions. So actually Arunanna yesterday told everything, whatever you have to do for a exam and all. But still I'm just mentioning again, because this is the first thing I learned from my seniors. So how much you are, if you are doing problems, that much it will help for you. So whenever you do problems, you will get more benefits. So these are some question papers like NBHM, CSER, GATE, TAFR, CMI, ISI. So those are like, from their website you can download their question papers. So you try to do those question paper. If you could not do, you ask your friends or your group. Finally, if you could not do, you can ask the doubts in the these websites, MathStart Exchange and Math Workflow. Those two websites are like solving questions on anything, like in higher level also, lower level also, even very basic questions also there. So you can post the questions there, they will answer it. So I think this much introduction is enough for the examples. I mean, for exam point of view, because actually Arunanna have settled everything yesterday. So let me go to the session.
Hello, Kumar.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, Kumar. Sorry for the introduction. Your voice is breaking. And also, is there any fan is running?
Okay. Wait.
Just kindly just to move on. Yeah.
So can you hear me now?
Yes. Yes. Now the voice is clear. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am. So these are some notations which I'm going to follow in this section. So N means, these are standard notations only. So N is natural numbers, Z is actual integers, Q is real numbers, Q is rational numbers, R is real numbers, C is complex numbers, and open A comma B interval, closed A comma B interval, and S1 is unity stream, complex plane, or R2. So now let us see the definition of limit point. So let me begin the definition. Suppose f is a function from E to R, E is a subset of R, then we can take some point P in R, not in E. So this is the main important point here. So P be a limit point of E if there exists a point Q in R with the following property. So the following property says, for every greater than epsilon greater than 0, there exists delta greater than 0, such that the distance between x and p is less than delta implies distance between f of x minus q is less than epsilon. Then we say f of x tends to q as p extends to p. So what they are saying exactly? So here the main thing which we have to note is the point p need not be inside the set e. That is the main first point. So here, so the limit point may not be in the set. So we can take any point outside, then we can check there is a limit point or not. That is the first point. So next, what is saying about, what is that property actually? So given any epsilon greater than 0, we have to find some neighborhood of Q in the codomain, which contains some points on F, right? Like, because actually Q is actually I mean, f is not dependent on p, so f of q may be anything, so it is not function of f. So now we have to find delta in such a way that you can find a delta neighborhood of p which is contained in the epsilon neighborhood of q under f. So you have to find a given a epsilon, you have to find a delta in such a way that delta neighborhood of p is contained in the epsilon neighborhood of q. So this is what, if you can find such a neighborhood, then that point p is called limit of e, and the point q is called limit point of limit value. So I will explain via this using this example. So here actually there are two things in real line. We can, I mean, okay, we will see that. So here I am giving the function f of x equal to x square minus 1 by x minus 1, but x is not defined at 1, because actually like f is not defined at 1. So now we have to find the limit at 1. So as I said, limit can be checked the points where x is not defined. Here I am going to define, because I am going to check where the limit is not defined, namely 1. So if I check the point, how we have to check first of all? So what is the meaning of the definition? So now we can see here from the definition, what is the meaning of this exactly from the example. So we have to approach 1 in the x axis. So we can have two things. So this is the real line. So suppose this is 1. So we can approach the 1 via these two way, right? First left side and right side, both the way we can approach. So here what I am going to do is, first I am going to approach via left side and approach via right side. So left side meaning 0.5, 0.8, 0.9, 0.999. So in that way I am just approaching. When I approaching that way, what happened to f of x? Also when I approach to right side, what happened to f of x? That way I am going to see. Whenever I am approaching right side and left side, both are coinciding onto some point, then limit will exist, and then the value of that is the limit. So that is what the main thing is. So here is the answer for that. So here, if you see the point, the image of f is 0.5 will be 1.5, 0.8 will be 1.8. So this is, whenever x approaches to 1 from left side, f of x approaches to 2, one can see that. Also from right side also, same thing happens. So whenever you are approaching to 1 from right or left side, you can get the value 2 in the image. So the limit of f of x at 1 is actually 2. So this will happen for any sequence. I'm just taking some particular numbers. So you can take any numbers, it will happen that. If it is happening like this, then the limit is this one. So this is the definition exactly meaning. So whenever you approach in the real line from x side or like right side or left side to that point, the image also will approach to some particular point. If it is happening, then limit exists. The limit of that number is that same. So now let us see the definition of continuity. So if it's from function from E to R, we say f is continuous at a point P. So here we have to note that the continuity also speaking at a point in E. Here we have to extra note that point is also in the set E. So function is defined at P. If there exists a point Q in R with the following property. So same property we have to satisfy, meaning mod f, distance between x and neighborhood of P, of delta neighborhood of P should contain in the x and neighborhood of f of P. So here the image of P also there. So f of P is neighborhood of epsilon neighborhood of f of P are chosen. Okay. This is the main thing here. Main difference between limit and continuity is actually two things. One is actually the point is may not be defined in the set for limit, but here the point should be defined, f should be defined on that point. Also another thing is actually, so if p is defined, so when you reduce the epsilon, the point f of x and the f of p will match somewhere, and when x and the p will match, so f of p should be same as limit of right and left limit. Right side or right limit and left limit should be same as the function value of the p. So that is was written in other words. In other words, the right limit at a p f of x equal to left limit at that point equal to f of p. So the function value on right limit, left limit, all should point shared in this case. Then it is called continuous at a point. Now, I sometimes use f of p plus or minus equal to limit extends, right limit, left limit. I will use some short notation f of p plus or minus. Okay. So now we will see the definition of continuous on real lines in the Wikipedia roughly. A real function that is a function from real number to real number can be represented by a graph in a Cartesian plane. Such a function is continuous if, roughly speaking, the graph is a single unbroken curve whose domain is the entire real number. So here what they are saying actually, so we have to consider function from real number to real number. For that function, we can find the graph of a function we have drawn in the school life itself. Those are like given a function, we can find x value and f of x is equal to y. We will draw the graph, right? That is actually drawn in a Cartesian plane. Cartesian plane is R cross R. There we have to draw a graph. If the graph is actually unbroken and single, then the curve is continuous. Then the function is continuous. So that means we can see the geometrical way of continuous functions. So given a function, we can draw the graph that will give some geometry to you. From that geometry, you can conclude that it is continuous or not. So this one can prove for real lines, even for any interval. So I'm going to use this fact mainly in further talks. So up to that, any questions? If you have any question, you can ask. Up to this, any questions? So participants, if you have any questions, you can unmute and then ask and then mute again. Okay. So any questions? Okay. So examples. So continuous functions, like if you ask continuous function example, you can say any function. So whatever functions you know, all are continuous in that domain. So in their domain, everything will be continuous. For example, trigonometric function, exponential, logarithm, polynomial. So whatever you say, almost everything is like continuous function. So hello, now I'm going hello?
Sir, you yes? wrote like f of 1 equals to 2. Can we write like that or we have to write a limit extends to 1 f of 1 equals to 2?
Where?
Actually, the function f of x is not defined at 1, right?
So you are saying about the question, example.
Example. X squared minus 1 by x minus 1. The function value is not x. The function is not defined at 1, right?
Yes, yes.
But so you have written f of 1 equals to 2.
So actually here what I have done is I have defined. So it is not defined in that function. Like if I have written f of x equal to x square minus 1 by x minus 1. So there it is not defined. So I have defined at that point equal to 2. So we can define like this. So that is also included in the function. So function is actually totally the function. F of x is equal to this one and f of 1 is equal to 2. Like those all contain, all the things together the function actually. So f of 1 equal to 2 is also included in that function definition. Okay.
But actually the limit is approaching to 2, right?
Okay, let me explain. So let me explain. If you have doubt, then you can ask. Okay?
Ma'am, the function is defined first. Only for other than one value, ma'am. Can you understand that? Yes, Selva, so you can speak okay. Continue.
So actually here, what we have done actually, we have to do right limit and left limit for the function f of x. So first let me see other than one, what about the continuity? So other than one, the function is continuous. Because actually that is the polynomial and quotient of two polynomial functions. X square minus 1 is a polynomial and x minus 1 is a polynomial. And the quotient of two functions are continuous. So those are some standard results. So provided the denominator is non-zero. So here actually, other than one, the function f of x is continuous. That is clear. But at a point one, we have to check. So that we can check from the previous lab, previous one. So here we have concluded that x square minus 1 by x minus 1 at x tends to x is in r minus 1. It is limit, the limit of that value is 2. We have concluded that. That actually one can see from x square minus 1 is actually x square x minus 1 into x minus 2. Then one can cancel out x minus 1 that when it is not equal to 1. It is when it is near 1, we can cancel out x minus 1, x minus 1. You will get x plus 1. F of x equal to x plus 1 near. F of x equal to x plus 1 near 1. So the function is x plus 1 actually, near 1. So in that point, if you find right limit and left limit, what you get is value is 2. So right limit is 2 and left limit is 2, and function value also I have defined it to be 2. So this function is continuous. So if I have defined if here f of 1 equal to some 3 or something, then what will happen? Right limit will exist and left limit will exist. Both are like 2, but the function value is not equal to 2. That may happen. So in that time, actually the function will not be continuous. So here I just want to mention that I have defined it to be f of 1 equal to 2. I have defined it, the function, that is also function definition. Okay. So now let's see the another example. So consider a function f from R to R defined by f of x equal to x plus 1 if x is greater than 2, and sine 1 by x if x is belongs to open 0 close to 2, and 0 if x is equal to 0, and e power 1 by x if x is less than 0. So anyone having any other than okay, where it is continuous, can you say, like, anyone can say that? So if you have any idea, you can unmute and then say the answer of this. Okay, so here other than 2 and 0, these functions are continuous. That we will see first. So x plus 1 is continuous, right? X plus 1 is a polynomial function, so it is continuous. And sine 1 by x is continuous on open 0, open 2. Why? That is a composition of function. 1 by x is continuous on 0, 2. And sine x is continuous on 0, 2. So composition of function is continuous. So we have sine x, sine 1 by x is continuous on open 0, 2. Also, e power 1 by x also continuous when x is less than 0. Yes, actually 1 by x also continuous in x less than 0, and e power x is also continuous. So composition of function you can use. In that case, e power 1 by x also continuous in x less than 0. Now, one thing we have to note it, only thing we have to find at 0 and 2. So for those two points, we have to find it is continuous or not, right? Now let's check right limit and left limit. So now can someone say the answer at a point 0 and 2? Is it continuous or not?
Actually, if you apply the limit on the right side of 0, at x equals to 0, the value is 0.
Okay, x equals to 0, value is 0. Why?
On the left side, actually the function is given x equals to 0.
Okay, is it good? Okay, function value is 0. Okay.
Actually,
what about the right limit and left limit?
E power 1 by x is given at x is less than 0. So if we apply the limit on the left side, we will get infinity.
E power infinity.
Yeah.
No, it is not e power infinity. That's what, like. So you are coming for the left side. That's the main point. So let me explain. So here actually.
E power minus infinity.
Yes, e power minus infinity. Why? So you are coming from the left side. So here is the proof. So at x is equal to 0, we have to find x is less than 0, right? Like you are coming from left side. So you have to take the function e power 1 by x. In that case, actually, function is coming from left side. So the left side is negative. X is negative. So it is coming like x by e power 1 by 2, e power 1 by minus 2, e power 1 by minus 3. Like if you are coming like 1 by n sequence, using 1 by n sequence, if you are approaching e power 1 by n, 1 by minus n, like minus 1 by n. So what you are getting e power n, e power minus n, e power minus n plus 1, e power minus n plus 2, like that you will get. The sequence will approach like that whenever using 1 by n, minus 1 by n sequence from the left side. So it is like e power minus n, n tends to infinity, like that it will approach. Okay. So finally, what you are getting, e power minus infinity, it is converges to e power minus infinity. That is value is zero. So here actually zero will get. We are getting right left limit. We are getting zero. So it is matching with function definition. What about right limit?
For x is greater than 0, it is sine 1 by x.
Yes.
So if we apply the limit on the left side, the right side, limit from the right side, sine 1 by
x.
1 by x, yeah. So.
Okay, actually the limit from right side will not defined. Let's see the proof. So sine right side, right limit will not exist for sine 1 by x when x approaches 0 plus. So one can prove that, I mean, actually, have you seen the function of sine 1 by x? The function of sine 1 by x will be like this. So 1 by will be like approach like this. Finally, here actually it is like zigzag. It is like approaching here very hotly. So this is the function of sine 1 by x. So why this is happening actually, whenever you go to 1 by n and 1 by n plus 1 interval, that will be here sine n and sine n plus 1 interval, right? So now consider sine 1 by 2n, 2 pi n and 1 by 2 pi n plus 1, those intervals in domain. So I'm saying 1 by 2 pi n and 1 by 2 pi n plus 1. If you consider those interval, those two interval will be, if you apply x is equal to 1 by 2 pi n, what do you get? Sine 2 pi n. And when you apply x is equal to 2 pi n plus 1, you get sine 2 pi n plus 1. So those will attain all the maximum, like all the interval. So sine function is defined on 0 comma 2 pi. So it will give all the values in between that. So when you approach using 1 by n sequence, you can easily see that every interval is coming each n by n. When you approach to 0, there are many intervals, such intervals, very small intervals. But those are giving the function value very, very big things. So those line full codomain will be obtained. Full codomain meaning I'm saying 0, 1. Sine codomain is actually 0, 1. Those full thing is obtained many times. So that's why the function will be look like this one. So in that case, if you apply limit tends to 0 from right side, what you get is all the values in that interval 0, 1. So the limit will exist, meaning that should be only one value, but here there are many values. So in that case, actually function is not defined. I mean, limit is not exist. Unique limit is not exist. So this is not true. So here also function limit is not exist in this case. So what about next one? At x is equal to 2. So when you approach x is equal to 2, you can directly say that sine 1 by x is same as sine 1 by 2. Whereas actually when you approach to 2 from left side, so here actually sine 1 by x is from left side and x plus 1 is from right side at a point 2. So when you approach from left side, what you get is sine 1 by 2. And here you will get 3. So sine 1 by 2 is not equal to 3. We can say, like, because actually sine x is less than or equal to 1. So we can easily say that these two values are not same. So here actually both the limits are defined, but it is not equal. So in the previous, at a point x is equal to 0, both the limit, one limit is defined and then it is equal to 0, but another is not defined, not exist. So this is how we can say that at a 0 and 2, the functions are not continuous. So let's see some other example. So this is in R2. So here I just want to mention that the function is continuous on other points other than 0, like that we won't can see. But I just want to mention that in R, unless like R in R2, we can have, if you have some particular point, we have many ways to approach the function. it is not one, two ways. Like in real line, we have only two, right? In real line, if you have one point, we can approach only two ways, right? Right side and left side. But in R2, it is not the case. There are many ways, uncountably many ways to approach a point. So we have to check all the ways. So it is not easy like in real line. In real line, we have to find only two limits, like right limit and left limit, but here it is not the case. So that I want to mention. That's why I have written here. So if you write like, actually, if you see this function, if you are approaching like x-axis and y-axis, these two are like defined to be zero and this will be continuous if you are seeing like that. But we have to see all the way. So that's why we have to see y equal to mx. I mean, here actually, if you see y is equal to mx way along the line y is equal to mx, if you approach, whenever you approach to zero, the function will be f of x comma mx equal to m by 1 plus m. So that is actually some constant. M by m, 1 plus m is constant for particular line. But it is not depending on m and n. So m is actually slope here. So slope will change for every numbers. So if you approach via different lines, you are getting different numbers. So finally, what will happen is like for a particular point, we have different limits via different sequences. So it should not happen for us. It should be one number. So here also the function is not continuous and zero. So now let me define the definition of uniformly continuous. Suppose a function f from E to R is defined. For every epsilon greater than zero, the axis delta greater than zero such that distance between x and p is less than delta implies f of x and f of p should be less than epsilon. Meaning same thing like continuous, but only the difference is the point is not fixed. I mean, we are not talking about a particular point. We are just choosing any point for a given epsilon. And delta also not depending on the point. Delta is depending only on epsilon. So that is the main thing here. So those things, like for referring those things, you can refer some books. There are some nice drawing. Those things you can see and then refer that. So here the main thing is actually the delta which we are finding is only dependent on epsilon. It is not dependent on point. So another main important is actually continuous is defined at a point. So at a, it is point property, but uniformly continuous set property. So we usually talk about the uniformly continuous on a set. So here continuous is at a point. So that is the main important thing. Okay. Now we see the definition of derivative. So differentiable at a point x. So here let f from a comma b to R. So why we are defining a comma b here? That is your like your exercise. I am giving this as exercise for you. Why we should not take any arbitrary set for differentiable function. I mean defining differentiable. You just check about that. Okay. Let f from a comma b to R be a function for any x naught in a comma b. We form a quotient f of x minus f of x naught by x minus x naught that we call as pi of x. Then we define a limit of pi of x as x tends to x naught. That will give the value that is that we have defined to be f dash of x naught. So first what we are doing is we are defining some quotient. What is that quotient actually? So can anyone say what is that quotient f of x minus f of x naught by x minus x naught? You can mute and answer.
Is that slope?
Yeah, it is slope. How?
Y1 minus y2 divided by x1 minus x2.
Yes, very good. So this is actually f of x. Usually we call in the xy plane is actually y is equal to f of x. That is what we are usually call. So given two point x comma x comma f of x and x naught comma f of x naught. That means x comma y, x comma x, I mean x one comma x two, something like x one comma y one. Then what you have to is actually slope is you can find. What is the slope? Slope is actually y two minus y one by x two minus x one. Full level we have studied. So this is actually slope of the line. Slope of a line. So this is actually slope of a line. So slope we are just finding the quotient for slope of a line, joining points x comma f of x, x naught comma f of x. And that slope of that point, now we are doing that x naught should approaches to x naught. But whenever in that time, the slope of the line will also approach to that. So we will see the diagram. So this is what the function, my function is x. and x comma f of x is here, and f x naught comma f of x naught is here. So that slope will be determining particular line, unique line passing through those two points, right? This is the line passing through those two points. Now what I have to do is, I have to do limit sending this x naught to x naught to x to x naught. This x should be approaching x naught. Whenever this x approaching x naught, what will happen to this x comma f of x naught? This line, actually the slope of this line. So whenever you approach here, you will get different points. Those slopes you have to find. For example, this one. So here you see. So I just changed the point. First point is at P1. Second point, when I approach here, from this point to this point, I will get P2 point. So I have to find the slope. Slope meaning slope of the point. Suppose this is P and P2. I have to see. And after, when you approach, whenever I approach here near to x naught, I have to see these things. So this is how we have to approach. Finally, what we are getting is some line which contains some slope. I mean, we will get some slope that is containing some line, some point, some slope, that is called the tangent. Tangent is T. I have drawn the tangent T. So that is what the slope of the tangent at a point for the curve F is the derivative of the function at a point. So this is clear, right? So now let me show something. So here is the function. This is the curve for me. The black curve is actually moving. One black point is fixed and another black point is moving, right? See that the line is actually my line, like line which is having slope, that whatever we have defined. So this, whenever this point is moving, that line also moves. So each point, whenever one fixed point and another point, when you move, that line also will get, that line also getting moved. Finally, when you approach to that point, actually here also we have to approach from right and left side. Here one side is they have drawn. So when you approach there, finally it should coincide. Meaning right limit also should coincide, left side limit also should show, okay? Finally, that, so whatever you are getting is actually derivative of that. So this is clear, right? Any doubt in this derivative definition?
Sir, I have one doubt.
What is it?
Sir, on the diagram show panning, actually, in the diagram, tangent means the line should pass through the curve at one point.
Yeah.
But you show the green line passes through more than one point.
No, actually, it is not like one point, meaning that touches one point, but it can cross the line. That is not a problem. Locally, it should touches one point. Tangent should touches one point locally. It is not like necessary to, like, this is clear, right? So if you study multivariate calculus, you can learn the what is the meaning of tangent and all. Like, though actually the tangent meaning is actually different. Those are in different dimension, actually. It's not in that line, actually. I mean, that I have to mention. See, if you study multivariable calculus, you can understand what is the meaning of tangent and all, right? So, okay. Like, I mean, that is some different concept. Like,
okay,
if you read that, then you will understand differently better. Okay. So let me move on some question. So here I have defined standard example. So mod x is continuous everywhere, but not differentiable at x equal to 0. So this continuity you can define. You can say, like I was giving the definition of mod x is equal to x if x is greater than or equal to 0, and minus x if x is less than 0. So from this definition itself, one can easily find the continuity. Like, as I have checked already right limit and left limit, one have to check actually only at 0, because actually this is polynomial. So one can check that. What about the phi of x? I mean, phi of 0, but at 0, what is P and right limit and left limit? So that one can see. Like, so we have to depend, the P of X is actually what we will get. What we are getting is actually at a point, like here also the poly X and minus X are polynomial. So derivative exists all other points except 0. So here at a 0, we can define the function is as mod X minus 0 by X minus 0. It will be like this. So, but here it is like, when you approach via left side, it will be minus x by x. So it will cancel out. That will give minus 1. Also, similarly, we can say for left limit. So phi of 0 minus is actually minus 1. Right? So if you do phi plus, what you get is actually plus 1. If you do the same thing, mod x by x you will get, and you have to take a limit, like limit, then what you get is actually here right side, if we are approaching via right side, x tends to 0 plus, then what you are getting is mod x equal to x, the function is defined like this, so it will give 1. So those functions tell you are not same. So the function is not, like, limit is not defined. Limit, right limit and left limit exist, but not equal. So limit is not exist. I mean, limit is not, that's why limit is not exist. Total limit, final limit is not exist. So this function is not differentiable at 0. So actually, if you see, exactly what happening is the function, here I have drawn the figure, right? There actually, those are like different tangent you will get. If you limit as x is, then different tangent, right limit will get some tangent or left limit and some tangent, but those tangent is not coinciding. That is what happening there actually. If you see that, let me draw the figure. So here actually, so suppose some function is like this. So let me draw mod x function. So when you approach from right side, you are getting tangent is like this, and left side you will get tangent like this. So those two tangent you will get, but those are not coincident. That's why the limit is not existing. Okay. So let me see another example. So can anyone say the answer for this? Okay, here actually what you have to do is, you have to do the same thing. You have to take right limit and left limit. You have to apply the same thing. So here actually f of x is cos x when you are taking left limit. So cos x minus cos 0 by x. I mean, you have to find this limit, and here also you have to find limit. So you have to do carefully when it is coming right side or left side. Like when it is coming from 0 minus, you have to come like negative numbers, and then you have to take it. So that you have to be careful. So I just left to you to think about it. Okay, let me see this one. So here, what about this function? Can someone answer for this?
It's not continuous. Sorry, this is not differentiable.
Where?
X minus 1 at 1 minus x minus 1 equals to x minus 1 is the graph is below the x axis. Yeah. So
no, there is 1, no point, it is below x axis actually. So, I mean, if you draw the graph, it is not, I mean, it will never be below the x axis actually. Okay, let me explain. So, if you use the mod x value, what you are getting is actually, I mean, when x is greater than or equal to 2, mod x value, if you apply mod x minus 1, and I mean separately for mod x minus 1, mod x minus 2, and add up in that separate level, what you are getting is this function. So you just check. So in the beginning, x is greater than or equal to 0, it is like x minus 1. And here also, greater than or equal to 2, it is x minus 2. So when you add up, you will get 2x minus 3. Also in the less than or equal to 1 also same thing, minus of x minus 1 you will get, and minus of x minus 2 you will get. When you add, you will get 2x plus 3, and in between like 1 and 2, you will get minus x minus 1 and x minus 1 and minus x plus 1. So you will get 1 actually. So these are continuous and all other points other than 2, 1 to 1. So that you can check, remaining point and 1 and 2 you can check. Actually, those are not differentiable at 1 and 2. So that you can check. In other words, how we can check is actually, one of my friend usually do this. Actually, I don't like, but still it is fine. It is workable. Like So he will see like in the neighborhood of 2, we know that x minus, like we have to check x minus 1 is not differentiable, right? At a point 2, it is not differentiable. But we know that at a point 2, mod x minus 2 is differentiable. So he will add mod x minus 2, he will subtract mod x minus 2 near the point x minus 2, near the point 2. So that there it will cancel out. So both are differentiable function there. So we are just adding differentiable function, so it won't take any problem. Finally, what you are getting is actually mod x minus 1. Suppose this f of x is differentiable, then total should be differentiable, and after adding also it should be differentiable. But after adding, you will get mod x minus 1 at a point 1. I mean, mod x minus 1 at a point 1, it will be not differentiable. So he will conclude finally it will not differentiable. So this is kind of funny, but still okay. Okay, so I will move on next one. So these are some examples for uniformly continuous. I mean, first one is for like nowhere continuous, and second one is for uniformly continuous. These are some standard examples. I think I just want to leave, for time being, I just leave to you how to do this and all. Okay, let me see some properties of continuity. So these are some properties which are important for our talk. So here actually first one is about limit. F of x tends to q at x extends to p, if and only f of pn tends to q for every sequence pn tends to p. Actually, in for continuous, what you can say is xn tends to x implies f of x tends to f of x for every sequence xn, then f is continuous. That is what here, like, that is what the short thing of skills. Here I have written in the limit point of view. Second result is actually main thing, which is for topological, like topology property, continuous image of some topology things. So continuous image of compact set is compact, and the continuous image of connected set is connected. So these two are playing main role if they ask there is a such function or not, like that. In that case, actually, these two theorems playing main role. If someone asks there is there any function from this domain to that domain, in that case, you have to use this kind of theorems. So third one is actually continuous function on compact set attains its maximum and minimum. Extremum meaning maximum and minimum. Fourth one is actually intermediate value theorem. This is also a very crucial thing. F is a continuous function on closed A comma B, then F assumes all the intermediate values C such that F of A less than C less than F of B. So that means actually if you are in the codomain, if you are having two images F of A and F of B, in between there is a point C, then the pre-image F inverse of C should exist. In that is also should be inside open interval A comma B. That is what it is saying. So fifth one is actually E is dense in E, then F of E is dense in F of X. If F is continuous. So like it is like dense image of dense is dense. Dense image of dense is dense in the onto like function image. Final one actually very important one. Monotone function has at most countably discontinuous where each term is of first kind. First kind meaning actually limit is exist, but they are not equal, those kind of things actually. Limit is exists, those kind of things. Limit should exist, but they are not equal, or like it is not equal to that function value, those kind of things. So you just keep in mind these things. Using this, we are going to solve some problems. So first one. So this is actually easy one. One can easily see that. So f is from R to R continuous such that f of R is equal to 0 when R is in Q. So whenever R is in Q, f of R is 0. So what can you say about function? Meaning I want the, what is the function? What is the function? Someone can say. So anyone? Okay, let me explain. So what we have to see is actually, we know Q is dense, right? Q is dense. Sorry. Same R, right? Q is dense in R. So what is the definition of dense? We are going to use the definition of dense. So what is the meaning of that? For any point x in R, like R in particular, I'm saying R minus Q, there exists a sequence xn in Q like each point of xn in Q which converges to x. So every point in the R can be approached by a sequence in Q. If it is possible, then the set is called Q, like Q is called dense. Like if this property is satisfied by some set, that set is called dense. Okay, here actually I'm going to use that fact. So what I know is actually every point in Q the function is zero. So what I have to find is, what about the other points other than the point from outside of Q in R? The function value I have to define, right? So using this I have to define. Now can you someone say, like, okay, so now what I have to do is I have to define. So here actually there is a sequence xn which is in Q which converges to x, right? Okay, now I have written xn converges to x, which implies what happened? F of x converges to f of x, because actually they are given f is continuous. They have given f is continuous, so xn converges to x implies f of x converges to x. But what happened here? For every element in R, element in Q, f of R is zero, right? So each xn is f of xn is zero here, because actually xn is in Q. So hence what happened? F of xn equal to zero. So this will be zero. Hence this is a zero sequence which will converge to zero. So hence what happened? This is here. For every point outside of Q, the function value will be zero. That means, hello? Okay, so for every point outside of zero, this function is zero. So totally the function is zero. So totally the function is zero function. That means for every f of x equal to zero for every x. So what about the second question?
Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Solunga.
F is defined only on closed interval a comma b. Limit f of x minus f of a by x minus a exists. Is f differentiable at b?
No, meaning? Oh, you are saying what? Which one?
And the f of b is a point differentiable, comma sir.
Being a point differentiable, comma and kicking la.
Ma sir.
So actually, what you have to do is you have to take care only left limit for boundary points. You have to take only left limit and bound, like, I mean, a, you have to take only right limit. So where, I mean, you could not approach from this side, right side for the b, right? So you have to do only for right side. I mean, only one limit only you can define. That limit exists, then there it is differentiable. That is what they are doing actually. Usually that is the definition. The definition says like that. Yeah, b also it is differentiable and all.
Thank
so
you,
that
sir.
Is definition. Okay, thank you. So now what about the second question? So can you say anyone, like, can someone answer the second question?
So I think the solution will not exist, sir. Is it correct?
Why?
So e power x will not take zero, am I right, sir?
No, it is actually, answer is wrong. There is a solution. Hint is actually intermediate value theorem. So now anyone can say this? Hint, intermediate value theorem. Okay, let me explain. So I will recall the intermediate value theorem first. So x, if you have some function, continuous function on x comma y, closed interval x comma y, then f of x, I mean, suppose there is a point c which is between f of y and f of x, or f of x and f of y, then there should be a preimage which is f inverse of c that should be inside x and y. So this is the intermediate value theorem. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to consider the function x into e power x minus 1. So I just want to say x into e power equal to 1, e power x equal to 1, but I'm just taking x into e power x equal to minus 1 equal to 0. So now if I say like there is a point 0, I mean some point it is 0, then it is fine, right? So now I'm going to say x into e power minus x will attain 0 at some point in open 0 comma 1. how I am going to say? So I'm just finding the value of zero, f of zero. What is f of zero? So f of zero will be e power x and e power x will be zero. So minus one. F of zero will be minus one for this function f. And f of one minus one will be e power. Sorry, f of one will be e power one minus one. So e minus one. It will be some 1 point something, right? Like e is actually 2.7 something like that. So e point 1 point something. So it is positive. It is negative. So by our intermediate value theorem, there is a value f of zero is some positive number, some negative number, and f of one is some positive number. So if you consider zero, there should be a pre-image inside open 0, 1. This is what intermediate value theorem is saying. So finally, from the intermediate value theorem, you are getting the answer. So whenever they are asking there is a point or there is a solution or there is a things in some finite interval, you have to first think intermediate value theorem. So intermediate value theorem is the main thing whenever you are asking there is a solution or not, there is a point or something like that. Okay. So next, this one. So this is a function. Function f from R to R is continuous such that f of x equal to f of x by 2. Then what can you say about it? I mean, here also I'm just asking what is it? Directly you have to say what is it? So this is some tricky question. Let's see like what is happening here. So f of x equal to x of f of x by 2 they have given, right? Only that is the constraint they have given. So what we can do is we can apply instead of x, x by 2. What you get? X by 4. So I'm just applying that actually. F of x equal to f of x by 2. Again, I am going to apply instead of x, I'm just applying x by 2 here in the given hypothesis. Then I will get f of x by 2. After that, again, I am giving like x by instead of x by x, I'm applying x by 4. I will get x by 8. If I do the same thing, I will get f of x by 2 power n somewhere, which is equal, like this is going like this, like x by 2, those are equal, like from the constraint here, what I'm getting is f of x equal to f of x by 2 equal to f of x by equal x by 4 equal to these things I will get. So now can you someone say the answer? Okay, so let me say the next one. So what I'm having is x by 2 power n is a sequence I'm getting in the domain. So if I apply x by 2 power n for f under f will be same, all the f will be same. So what I can say is x by n is converges to, for fixed x, x by x n is converges to 0. Like x by 2 power n also subsequence of x by n. So that is also converges to 0. For fixed x by 2 power n converges to 0. I think this is fine, right? X by 2 power n is converges to 0. So from that, what I can say is actually now f is continuous. So I can use that sequence criteria. So f of x n converges to x, then f of x converges to f of x. That I can use, right? Now I am doing that. So f of x by 2 power n converges to f of 0, right? This is from the sequence criteria for continuous. So now what I am getting? F of x by 2 power n converges to 0. But what I know, each point are same. Like every point, every f of x by 2 power n is 0 for every n. For every n, if this is 0, that means this function is constant function, right? F of x by 2 power n is a constant function because actually every point is same. I mean at a point, at least this sequence is constant sequence. F of x by 2 power n is a constant sequence. So constant sequence is converges to f of 0. That means what? So constant sequence converges to same constant. So that constant should be above 0, right? That's why I have written f of 0 is equal to f of x equal to f of x by 2 is equal to these things. So all the functions will be 0 for every fix x. So that means f should be f of x should be a constant function with the constant f of 0. So if you define the value at f of 0, the constant will be there. Like that is the constant function. So this is clear, right? Like for any x you take and do the same process, you will get the same thing. Finally, you will get that f of x is equal to f of 0. That's why this is a constant function with the constant value f of 0.
Sir, how do you say that f of x by 2 power n is a constant sequence, sir?
No, actually, these are same, right? F of x equal to f of x by 2 equal to f of x by 4. Those all the terms are equal, right? First line itself, I have written the same. That's what I have written, right? F of x equal to f of x by 2 equal to f of x by 4 equal to, all are same, meaning what? That is some number, every number is same. everything is some numbers, but all are same. That means that is same number. So it is a constant, right?
Thank you, sir.
So now let me move on next question. Let f from R to R be a continuous function. Assume that f of x tends to 0 as mod x tends to infinity. Is there a point C in R such that either f of x less than or equal to f of c or f of x greater than or equal to f of c for all x in R? So for this, actually what we have to understand is mod x tends to infinity mean what? So mod x tends to infinity, f of x tends to 0. With that we have to understand. The meaning of that is what? Like after some stage, big M, after some big M, the function f of x, it will approach to 0. It means there is this excellent neighborhood. In that neighborhood, all the points, after some stage, all the f of x would be there. That means what here? Let's see here. So this is domain x and the f of x is a codomain line. I'm just writing real lines. So here, mod x tends to infinity, meaning there is a stage M. After the stage, every value of that should be going into the some excellent neighborhood of 0. That is what the meaning of that. F of x tends to 0 as mod x tends to infinity, meaning after some stage, like infinity also, minus M comma M, there is a big M. After that, everything should go to inside of the 0, neighborhood of 0. That is the definition. That is the meaning of that. Now what we have to do is actually f of x is less than or equal to f of c or f of x is greater than or equal to f of c. For some c in R we have to show. For that, what I can do is actually the function now remaining dependent is minus m comma m. Minus m comma m is the only points where the function is defined. So now we have concluded that minus m comma n is the function defined only at that, but this is compact, so it will attain maximum minimum, say some c and c dash. This is maximum and this is minimum for that function. So we have seen this will attain maximum and minimum and all. So from that, actually what we can say is that this inside minus m comma m, there is a maximum m and minimum minus m. Also there is a epsilon. So using that things, one can find that which one is minimum, epsilon is minimum or m is maximum. And finally, we can choose m. Finally, we can choose c. Why actually? F of c is the, f of c, the points where it is maximum is the largest part. After that, the function will not go. There is no point of function is there. For example, like this. So here the peak point is the maximum. So this is the maximum point. Above that point, there is no maximum actually. So there is no function value. There is no function. This is going above, right? This is the maximum point. So this may be a C. Here also, if you see, this is the minimum, lowest minimum. This is maybe C minus C, C dash for me. So from that, what I can do is, what I can conclude is, there is a C, which will be saying f of c should be less than or equal to f of x and or f of x greater than or equal to f of c, right? So this is some example of that. So here what I have done is, after that m, this is my epsilon neighborhood. In that epsilon neighborhood, I should have drawn little epsilon neighborhood. So maybe I can choose here, this is my epsilon neighborhood of the zero function. Then actually after the stage, after this m, this function will go here. After this m, this function will say go inside the epsilon neighborhood, and there is a c and c dash. Those are the function which we are choosing. Now let's see some properties of uniformly continuous. So uniformly continuous of continuous functions on a compact space is uniformly continuous. These are very important things. If you know all these things, you can solve almost every questions in uniformly continuous. So derivative is bounded, then f is uniform. F is uniform on open A comma B. If and only if, it can be extended to closed set. So whenever they are giving open A comma B and then find the derivative, continuous of that, uniformly continuous, then what you have to do is you have to try to extend into compact set. Then automatically continuous function defined on the compact set is uniform, so it automatically defined. you have to extend meaning continuously you have to extend. Okay. Fourth one is F is uniformly continuous on open A comma B, open A close to B and on close to B open C. Then like both the interval it is uniform, so we can merge the interval. You can say in open A comma C also it is uniform. And if it is periodic on R, then it is uniformly continuous. If F is F from R to R continuous such that F of X tends to a finite value in the both the side of infinity, like in X tends to infinity also, F of X, X tends to minus infinity also, F of X is going to finite value, then it automatically uniform on R. So the final one is very important, which can be used to prove the function is not uniform. Okay, F is continuous on R, A continuous on A in R, if one only for every sequence x comma x n comma y n in A which converges to zero, x n minus one z, I mean and x n minus y n converges to zero implies f of x n minus f of y n converges to zero. That means you have to take two sequence x n and y n, then find x n minus y n. If it is converges to zero, then f of x n minus f of y n converges to zero. You have to show. If it is there, then the function is uniformly continuous for every sequence. If there is a sequence xn, there are two sequences and xn yn whose differences are not going to zero, but the images of those differences are not going to zero, then you can easily say that it is not uniformly continuous. We will see the example of that. This is some example, some question. So what about this one? So as I said, we have to see first interval open 0 comma 1 they have given. So you have to see is can be extendable or not. Now you can say like in one you can easily extend that, right? When you apply one, extendable meaning what? You have to find a limit approaching that point from left side or right side. It depends on the where is the point is. Then you have to define the value. Like if it is x limit exists, then you can define. For example, here at a one you have to find left limit, and the limit value is actually cos 1 cos pi. That is a finite value, so you can define it. So limit is exists, so there you can extend. But in zero you could not extend. So in zero, if you try to extend, cos pi by x will be like same thing like sine x. Sine x we have taken, no, sine 1 by x take many intervals. No, same here also it will have cos pi by x will have many interval. So it is not uniformly continuous in this case. So if we have written sine x into cos pi by x, it will be uniform. You just check, okay? So next one. So there is a result that uniform composition of uniformly continuous is continuous. So using that, this result one can prove. So if you have two uniformly continuous, those composition also uniformly continuous. So here for that you have to check cos x is uniform and sin x is uniform. Finally, the composition also uniform. Check. So this one is some tricky question. This is actually about I'm just going to split the interval in like my interval is close to 0 comma infinity. I'm going to split that interval into close to 0 comma 1 and close to 1 comma infinity, and I'm going to argue. So how I'm going to argue is like this. So bounded derivative on close to 1 comma infinity. So if I see actually in close to 0 comma 1 it is compact. So compact interval the function is defined, so it is uniform. And close to 0 comma infinity it is bounded derivative. So one can check this argument actually. From that what I can do? I can merge those two interval to say that in 0 comma infinity or close to 0 comma infinity also it is uniformly continuous. So this is how we have to merge somehow. Like sometimes it is not easy to say, so we have to cut the interval and then say these things and merge those also you can do. So this is actually some like this which I have written the proof of the derivative is bounded. This is some tricky thing, you just check out. Like I mean this is easy, I have given full complete solution, but you just check out. Okay, so now we come to this one. If f of x is equal to sin x square, so you have to find actually here x equal to x belongs to R also you can take. Okay, so here is the tricky question. This is not uniform, so how I am going to prove is using sequence criteria. So I am just taking xn and yn xn equal to root of 2n pi and yn equal to root of 2n pi plus pi by 2. Now what I have to do is xn minus yn has to zero, tends to zero I have to show. then what I have to show is f of x n minus f of y n does not tends to 0. That I have to show. If I have showed that, then I can prove that sin x sin of x square is not uniform. So this is the proof. So x n minus y n, x n minus y n is actually this one.
Sir?
So now I can, yes, sir.
Sir, I have doubt for uniformly continuous properties.
Okay.
Fourth property, this exam, fourth property says that continuous periodic function in R is uniformly continuous.
Okay.
So any interval in R, is it uniformly continuous? We say that sine of x is not uniformly continuous in 0, infinity.
Yes.
So any interval in R, it is uniformly continuous or not?
Any interval in R meaning? Oh, that's sine of x square. Any interval it is uniformly continuous, because actually you can extend it into compact set. So that is uniformly continuous. That's what I'm saying. It is depends on the domain. It is not depends on the, I mean, actually it is not periodic. Sine of x square is not periodic, I guess. You just think about it actually. But here actually in infinite interval it is not true. See, for example, any function if you take which is defined on R, that is uniformly on compact set, right? So you can reduce the interval, like open interval or something. For example, x, I mean 1, 2 it is uniform. I mean 1, 5 it is uniform. Then you can reduce the interval into 2, 3, open 2, 3. Still it is uniform because actually subset, I mean those things you can see, right? So in that case it is fine, but here you just look about this example, then we will see that. So here actually what we have to say is x n minus y n tends to 0, we have to say. So for that what I am doing is here I'm just taking conjugate, meaning f root of 2n pi plus root of 2n pi plus pi by 2. Then when I multiply what I am getting is pi by 2 by this one. This will converge to 0, but what about f of x n minus f of y n? If you do that, I am getting sine 2n pi, because like the sine square is there, x square is there, I will get this, and sine of 2n pi plus pi by 2. So if you have the different, what I am getting is minus 1, so which is not 0. So hence what I can say is actually xn for this sequence xn minus yn tends to 0, but f of xn minus f of yn may not be 0.
Sir, I have a question, sir. So, if a graph that's parallel to x-axis, it is uniformly continuous, அப்படினு சொல்லலாம்ல சார்.
Okay.
அந்த ரிசல்ட் வச்சு நம்ம போலாம்ல சார். ஏ சார், நம்ம வந்து ப்ராப்ளம் சால்வ் பண்ணி போறோம்.
புரியல, graph? Graph?
Graph வரைஞ்சு, sine x graph வரைஞ்சுனா, the graph that parallel to x-axis, parallel to y-axis, அதை வச்சு நம்ம வந்து uniformly continuous இல்லையான்னு சொல்லலாமா சார்?
சொல்லலாம், பட் எப்ப சொல்லலாம்னா அந்த கிராப் வந்து பேரலல் டு சம் அதர் யூனிஃபார்ம்லி கன்யூஸ் ஆர்னா சொல்லலாம். ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள், இப்ப எக்ஸ் ஆக்சிஸ், ஐ மீன் வாட் எவர் யூ ஆர் சேயிங் இஸ் ஆக்சுவலி ஃபார் எக்ஸ் ஆக்சிஸ் இட் இஸ் பேரலல் டு சம் அதர் ஃபங்க்ஷன் பேரலல்னா வாட் இஸ் தட் ஆக்சுவலி? எக்ஸ் பிளஸ் சம்திங், லைக் ஐ மீன் தட் இஸ் ஆல்சோ சம் ஷிஃப்டிங் ஆஃப் தட் எக்ஸ் ஆக்சிஸ், ரைட்? சோ இட் இஸ் ட்ரூ, பட் ஹியர் இட் இஸ் நாட் பேரலல், ரைட்? ஃபார் எக்ஸ் ஆக்சிஸ் இட் இஸ் சைன் எக்ஸ் ஸ்கொயர் இஸ் நாட் பேரலல், ரைட்?
ஓகே சார்.
சோ யூ ஹேவ் டு யூஸ் தட் எக்ஸாக்ட்லி, லைக் பேரலல் மீனிங் யூ ஹேவ் டு சீ தட் is it parallel or not, but here it is not parallel, right?
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you. So now the some properties of derivative. So derivative, like derivative is zero when the function reaches maximum and minimum, maximum or minimum. And this is the main theorem, main thing, mean value theorem. So function is from a comma b to R is continuous and differentiable on open a comma b. Then there is a point C in open a comma b such that f of b minus f of a by f of m equal to b minus a into f dash of x. So this is kind of someone can draw the figure for this also. So third one is actually mean value theorems for derivatives. For the derivatives also there is a mean value theorem. That is what here written. F is differentiable on a closed a comma b, then f dash assumes all intermediate values c such that f of a naught a dash of a less than c less than f dash of b. So this means here for there actually we are finding f of a and f of b are there, then in between some number, then free image should be exist in the open a comma b. Here also we are saying for the derivative also this is true. Okay, the final one is actually main thing which will try to help to prove increasing and all. So suppose f is differentiable on open a comma b, then for all x in open a comma b f dash of x is positive greater than or equal to 0, then f is increasing. Less than or equal to 0, f is decreasing. And equal to 0, f is constant. So if it is greater than 0, only greater than 0, then f is strictly increasing. Less than 0, then if it is strictly decreasing. Okay. So now see some example. So this is actually some like useful way of saying some application of mean value theorem. So can anyone say this answer?
So strictly increasing na greater than or equal to symbol varakudadana sir?
Yes, I have told no, like greater than or equal to meaning increasing just, okay? Strictly increasing is greater than 0, okay? Strictly increasing means greater than 0.
Okay, sir.
So this is a function I have given, p of x equal to some polynomial of 2020 degree. Now I am saying all the roots of p of x are real and distinct. Then find the roots of number of real roots of p of 36th derivative of x. So here what you can do is use the mean value theorem. So what I am going to do is, this is my real line. Suppose I am having 2, 3, like some value. These are my value. Like actually, you know that like function, when the function is touching like this, then the solution zero, the function is zero at these points, right? Whenever x, the function touches x axis, there the solution, like the function is zero, f of x is zero, right? This we know, right? That is the solution of that function. So now I am considering, these are my solutions, some points I have taken, these are my solutions. Now what I have to do is, I have to apply the mean value theorem. So mean value theorem, what mean value theorem between consecutive roots. Suppose this is a1, a2, a2, an. I have named it like this, a2020, like that. Then I have to apply any consecutive ai and ai plus 1. I have to apply mean value theorem. If I apply the mean value theorem, what I will get is this one. Like, so mean value theorem saying f of x minus f of y equal to f dash of c and x minus y, right? So here f of x and f of y are zero. We are considering only roots and the roots of the point. Here actually a i plus 1. So here if I consider these two things, what I am giving is these are zero. So this will be zero, which is equal to f dash of c. So there is a point in between. So if I have two points, there is a maximum, this one, like the point where the tangent is zero. Here actually the tangent is zero, right? Same thing, this will happen or like this will happen. Like I will get minimum. There the point will be zero. So whenever I have some three things, I'm giving two points which are like maximum or minimum. Also, like whenever I'm having this many roots, like meaning 2200 roots, then for the derivative of that, I will get 2019 roots I will get for the derivative. So if you take second derivative, it will reduce again one. I will get 2018 I will get. So finally, if you apply for 36 times, what you get? So I have to subtract 2020 minus 36 I have subtract. So this is how the proof goes. Okay. So now this is an interesting question. So does there exist a differentiable function from f from R to R such that f dash of x is equal to integral part of x? Integral part of x meaning like the greatest integer less than x. Suppose this is x, you have to find the x greatest integer less than x. So suppose this is x, then the integral part of x is like greatest integer less than x. For example, if I consider some 0.5, then my answer is greatest integer less than x will be 0. For example, and 5.7 meaning greatest integer less than x is 5. If I get some minus 2.5 meaning, I will get minus 3. Because actually in the real line you have to check. So the minus 3 will be here and minus 2.5 here. So greatest integer less than 2.5 is 3, minus 3 only, right? So that's how we have to see, right? So this is the definition of this. So this is the graph of that. So graph is like this. So graph of integral part of x looks like this. So for, because actually for 0.1 we will get value 1 only, right? So that's why the line in 1 0 corresponding to 1 we are getting outcome in the line which like 1 tuple. So this is the function. Now can you someone say the answer?
So I think it will not be differentiable, sir. Am I correct?
Why? Meaning, I mean, okay.
Discontinuous points irukla sir nadula. So namba ella point layum continuous irundha differentiable nu sollalam. Inga discontinuous point irukadhal namba differentiable varadhu nu
sollalam. No, actually see. Wait. Question, you just clearly understand the question. Does there exist a differentiable function? So I want to find a function which is differentiable whose derivative is integral part of x. So the derivative, after taking a derivative, this graph should come. There is some function, after taking derivative of that function, this graph should come. That is what the question is. Now it is clear, right? So I have some function g, this f is my function. So after taking derivative, I should get this function. Okay, let me explain the thing. So here also we are going to use intermediate value theorem for derivatives I am going to use. So for example, I am just consider this point. This is in between 1 and 2. So f of something is 1 and f of something is 2. For example, f of 1 is 1, f of 3 is 2, f of 2.5 is 2, right? In between x, I mean x, I'm just taking x is equal to 1 and y equal to 2.5. okay, now I'm just applying derivative. Like what is the image of that? Image will be f of x will be, suppose there is a function I'm assuming, then I'm doing this. This will be f of x will be 1, f of y will be 2, right? So I'm just taking in between, there is a point C, which is like some 1.5 or something. So I'm just trying to find the pre-image of that. So there is no pre-image for that. That means what? This will be a problem, right? Like what I have to do actually. So I have to say this one, right? So if I have some number like this, real line, like, I mean, so what I have to do is actually given any point in between two numbers, I have to show there is a number in the domain in between those two numbers, the x and y. If I have f of x and f of y, and there f dash of x and f dash of y, there is a point in between them, then I should say if the pre-image of that, like there is a point corresponding to, from that what you can say is actually there is no such thing. Maybe I will write clearly. So what I'm saying is actually, so these are two lines, like this is my, like this is f dash thing and this is the domain. So suppose x and y are there, and here I have f dash of x, f dash of y. So if I have some point C here, then I should have something like some d or something. After taking derivative, f dash of d should be C. This I should have from the property. Like what I should is, like how should I, it is f dash of d should be C. But I am not getting here, right? That is what we are not getting here. So that's why this function is not defined. Like there is no such function. Okay, let's move on next one. So this is actually about, this is also something like play with mean value theorem. So you can consider f of x equal to tan inverse of x. Then what we are getting is f of x minus f of y is less than or equal to x minus y. So this is like some f dash is missing, right? So what I have to do is f of x minus f of y, I mean, it's equal to f dash of x into x minus y. This is my definition. So f dash of x, here f of x equal to tan inverse of x. So derivative f dash of x equal to what? 1 by 1 plus x square, which is less than 1, right? So what I can do is, I can apply the limit for that. I can apply the modulus of that, modulus for both the sides. Like here, like I can say that here actually which is less than mod x minus y. See, I can apply the f dash of x value, and then I can forget, like it should be like 1 by 1 plus x square or c square into mod x minus y less than equal to f of x minus f of y. So this should happen, but here, like here there is a equality, but I can say that like this should be less than or equal to, I mean, I have written very badly, but still. So like, is it clear, right? I should have typed it. So what I'm saying is actually f of x minus f of y equal to f dash of x into x minus y. Modulus, like I have taken modulus everywhere. Now this is less than one, like f dash of x is 1 by 1 plus x square, which is less than one. So I can multiply both sides mod x minus y. This is minus y actually. So derivative is 1 by 1 plus x square, which is less than 1. So I can multiply both sides mod x. So mod x minus y, and here also mod x minus y times the f dash of c, which is less than this. So I can replace this by less than mod x minus y in the definition of mean value theorem. So from that we can easily conclude that this inequality is true. So now let's see this one. So here actually, if b a real valued function, f dash is on open a comma b, f dash of x is non-zero. We have to show f is 1-1. So f dash of x is non-zero means what? For every, f dash of x may be positive or less than negative, right? If it is positive, then function is increasing, strictly increasing, and if it is negative, strictly decreasing, right? So this is the hint. So hint is actually, this is positive, f dash of x, positive or negative, which implies increasing or decreasing. F is increasing or decreasing. Okay. Using that, you have to show f is 1-1. So you can directly apply the definition of 1-1. You will get that actually. You write that f of x is less than x less than y implies f of x less than f of y. That is the definition of increasing. From that, if you apply the 1-1 definition, you will easily get it. So these are some some problems which you can work on uniformly continuous. And okay, I think I'm not having such time. So can I say this one? Okay, which one? Like these are four. There are four problems. So I think second and third are easy ones. Easy ones meaning I have already solved fourth problem. And for second problem, actually, that is actually similar to the right limit, left limit, that one. I have discussed fully discussed the right limit, left limit idea. So I think second one you can do, and then fourth one also you can do. If you have any doubt, you can post in the, maybe I will explain. And what about first, third, and fifth one? So somebody have any idea, then you can tell. So I can say third one is tricky one. I mean, I have told already if there is a point or something, what you have to use? Somebody? If there is a point on some interval, finite interval, then what you have to do?
Intermediate value theorem, sir.
Yes, intermediate value theorem. But how? But for what? Which is the, what is the continuous function? Those things you have to define. Yes, very good. Intermediate value theorem you have to use. First, you have to come up with the answer, like which you have to use. That you have to, which tool you have to use. That is fine. but what is the function, how we have used, that is the only thing here. So let me explain here. Yes,
integration 0 to x x to the power alpha sin x.
Integration 0 to x?
X to the power, integration 0 to something 0 to t, x to the power alpha sin x. This
okay,
is
x, which going to where? Like x go, t, t goes to this, okay? You are saying like that.
Mm-hmm.
No, yes, it is not true actually. So let me write that. Like, I mean, actually this is like more tricky thing. So I am defining f from open 0, 1 to r such that x going to integral 0 to pi. Actually, I want alpha in open 0, 1. So alpha should vary for me, right? Nothing should vary, but only alpha. Alpha should vary for me. So x power alpha, like, I mean, here I'm just say, taking, sorry, this is, okay. So here actually I should say, this one is not x for me. So here it is alpha. The function, my function is in alpha. Alpha into sin x dx. So this is my function. Now I have to show this is continuous. Like, I mean, this actually, it is not easy to show continuous. There you have to use some sequence and series of functions. That, I mean, you have to show, for showing this, you have to use something like, I mean, some small observation on sequence and series of functions. Then you can say this function is continuous. Now you can use the remaining fact to prove this is, I mean, this result is true. There is a point alpha in open a comma, open 0 comma 1 such that this is true. That you have to show. Further, what you have to do, we have to find at a point 0, I mean, you have to apply alpha is equal to 0 in this function, meaning 0 to 1, 0 to pi, x power 0 sin x dx. You have to find that. That will be some number. I think that is 1 or something. And what you have to do again is, like, you have to find at when x alpha is equal to 1, you have to apply 0 to pi x sin x dx. There you have to find the answer. I think that you will get pi or something. Those are like 3 will be between those two numbers. So there is a pre-image alpha such that this will happen. So that is the idea. So, like, I have given the idea for that proof. Like, you just check it. If you have some doubt, you can ask again. So what about first one and third one? So those two are simple only. First and third are simple only. So first one is actually like about countable uncountable criteria. Like, see, f of x. So I will let me explain. See, actually f of q is contained in q complement, right? F of q union f of q complement equal to r, right? This is true, right? But I can say f of q union, instead of q complement I'm writing q. This will be more set, it will contain more element, right? It will be bigger than actually, this will be subset of, I mean, this may contain more element, but still it is r. What about this one? So f of q meaning q contain countably many numbers. So countably numbers image will be countable, and union with countable number will be countable. So total it is countable. So it is equal to r. I mean, if it is continuous and it is true, I mean, if it is a function, then it is true, then this will happen. But what should be happening? What should happen actually? I mean, it is not equal to r first. I mean, the idea is like this only, like q, f of q has countable number and f of q complement also have countable number. Countable. So these are having countable value only. Like, these are like image of R. They are contained in R. They are only having countable number of values. So the image, the countable number of value it is having. So the countable set may not be connected. Because for R it is connected, meaning that is only intervals that should have uncountably many numbers. But the function is continuous, meaning. Continuous meaning countable in image of countable, like countable domain is connected. So f of connected set should be connected. That means our image should be connected, but image is having only countable number. So image is connected only when that is singleton set. right? So it has to be a singleton set. So domain has codomain image of the F should be a singleton set. So is it clear? From that, actually, what you can say is F is a constant function. So if it's some constant function, then only this should be true. Otherwise, it is not true.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
Yes.
F of Q union F of Q complement. So we know that countable union of countable set is countable. Am I right,
yes.
sir?
Yes, yes, yes.
So R is uncountable, then, sir?
Yeah, R is countable. But we don't have to consider R, right? Because the function image may not be onto. Function may not be onto.
Okay, sir.
So that's what I'm saying. Function image is countable, but domain is like connected set. So it has to be connected in the codomain also. Image should be connected. But countable set is connected only when it is a singleton set. That's why the function image should be a singleton set. That means function is constant. Clear?
Thank you, sir.
So I think this much is enough. I think, I mean, fifth one also similar to the answer, similar questions, similar answer you have to show. What about next one? So what about this one? There is a continuous function, one function from closed 0, 1 to open 0, 1. Continuous 1, 1 function. So if it is a continuous onto, then we can easily say that it is a compact set of closed 0, 1 is a compact set. So continuous image of compact set is compact. So codomain is not compact. That we can say if the function they are given onto also. If they have given it is onto, then we can easily say. But here they are not given, it is onto. So what is the way to prove this? Anyone having some idea? Okay, let me explain. So this is the idea actually. So what I am going to do is that this result is true. There are many functions, such functions. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to shrink the interval. This is my domain. 0, 1 is my domain and the open 0, 1 is my codomain. I'm going to shrink the interval. I will multiply by 1/2 or something. I will get some 1/2 length interval. I can put that interval, this one into here. So I'm just embedding, meaning I am just putting this inside that with the same kind of thing. But these two, like mapping between 0, 1 and to a, b will be a 1, 1 function. So that I'm going to do, meaning I can take some, first I can map to some 1/2 x. 1/2 into x, and I can put it. I can shift somewhere something, and then I can put it here. Shift by some 1/4. I will come here. I can put it here. So I can put the closed interval clearly here, like this function. If I can define, so 1/2 into x is actually 1, 1 function for me. So that 1, 1 witness is preserved. And my interval will be closed interval 0, 1/2, like if I do 1/2 plus 1/2 x only. So I'm just shifting that again, shifting it 1/2, I'm shifting it so that I will get this. So this is not the only function, you can do many functions. That's why I'm just mentioning in the graph. What you have to do is you have to shrink, meaning using one, like which whenever you shrink, the domain close to 0, 1 should be 1, 1. And continuously, the function should be continuous, and it is 1, 1. Something like that you have to string and put inside. That will give you a function. Because we don't have to on. We don't need onto, so we can do this. Right. So in other words, what I am having is this one. So this is the function actually. In other words, this is the exact function. So what I am having is closed 0, 1 map to a, b. So this is my first point. 0 will go to a, and 1 will go to b. In between there is a line. Like this is just a line joining those things. So this is the exact graph for that. I mean, exact example, one example have given for that. So what about next one? There is a continuous onto from open 0, 1 to closed 0, 1. So for this also, there is a tricky thing. So maybe let me explain like this. So here actually, open 0, 1 to closed 0, a, b, we have to put. There is an onto function. There is no need of 1, 1. There is an onto function from open 0, 1 to closed a, b. So what I have to do is, I just to pin two points A and B in the open 0, 1 interval. I'm just pinning two points. A and B are two pin points here. I'm just putting two pin points A and B, and I'm just mapping A and B to open 0, 1. Those interval close to A comma B, there is the interval close to A comma B inside my thing. There I'm just mapping into open close to 0, 1. Then I'm just folding other things. Folding meaning folding remaining B to 1 interval and the A to 0 interval into folding. Like we are like bestit, we are just folding. No, we are just folding the bestit or something. Something like that, I'm just folding here. So this part I'm just folding like here I'm just folding. This will map to here and remaining part will map to here. Something like that I'm just folding. I just map this full thing A comma B into 0, 1 and remaining thing I'm folding. This is, if you see, this is like one, like this is just like one dimensional view. If you see the same thing here, what happened is this one. So this is what, like this is my full link A to B. Like this line is full thing that 0, 1 map, this one map fully, like A comma B map to full 0, 1. And remaining thing I'm just folding here. This is my folding to somewhere here. Also this is folding, these two are folding, and this is full thing. Okay, so this kind of function we can do. So this is also one example. So what about next example, next question? So there is a continuous bijection from S1 onto open 0, close to 0, 1. S1 is a circle on R2, RC. So what we have to do here? So here actually S1 is compact, that we have to show. We have to know S1 is compact. So now we can go to the proof. So what I'm doing is, consider circle S1. S1 I have drawn. Now consider close to 0, 1. I'm going to use connectedness property. So like bijection from onto, meaning I can say, okay. Okay, I have done ulta here. So I have done this ulta function. So I have not given correct function actually here. Sorry for that. Okay, I have given ulta function here actually. I have given the proof for ulta, like meaning if there is a function from close to 0, 1 to S1, what will happen like that. So for that I have given, but someone can prove the same thing, similar thing, like not similar thing. I mean, this one can view like, okay, I will tell that again. Now let me explain this. Suppose I have function from close to 0, 1 to S1, what will happen? Bijection onto function from close to 0, 1 to S1. So this is bijection. So what I can do is, in the domain, I can remove 0. I will get F inverse of 0. That I can remove. So I'm just restricting function to that open 0, close to 1. So this will remove some point F inverse of 0. Also in the domain, if I remove 1, then here codomain F inverse of 1 will remove, because actually it is bijection. So those things will remove. So now what I can do is, finally what I'm getting is, there is a function from open 0, 1 to two different disjoint things. So this, what we'll get is, after cutting two points in the circle, you will get two different things like this. So the domain is connected, but codomain is not connected. From that, what you can conclude, there is no such function. Meaning there is no such function from close to 0, 1 to S1 continuous bijection. Okay. So now this is actually ulta, like ulta meaning close to 0, 1 to S1 I have given. Now I have to give reverse thing. A proof for reverse one. So this actually one can view like the graph of this will be in a cylinder. So one can use a cylinder. So this is my 0, 1. This is S1. So like S1 is domain, this is domain, this is codomain. S1 is domain, this is codomain. Now what we have to do is, you have to come up with a circle which is going, I mean, this is actually for your homework. You have to come up with a question, I mean, come up with a circle which is going diagonally. Diagonally meaning what? Here actually, in usual plane, the diagonal meaning we are drawing like this diagonal. But here, what is the domain is S1. So we have to draw diagonal in different way. How we have to draw the diagonal, that you have to think. Before that, I will explain this one. So this S1 can be treat like, consider a line and attach these two points. these two point attach meaning just join those point, take a dot and the end point you can attach the dot. So that is what the what you are getting is circle, right? That you can think of, you will get S1 cross 01 will be this one, and this will be identified. These two will be identified so that you will get cylinder. Meaning you take a paper and then two opposite side, you just identify what you are getting is cylinder. Okay, this is fine, right? Now you have to come up with the circle. Circle meaning here there is a line you have to come up with, that when you identify, those should give a circle. That should not happen, that you have to prove. Okay. That you prove. If you have any doubt, you ask me, I will let you. So what about the third one? Third one also similar thing. So here what you have to do is there is a continuous 1-1 function from S1 into closed 0-1. There is only one onto is missing from the previous question. So what you have to do is S1 is connected in the compact. So the image of, suppose there is a function from 1-1 function from S1 to closed 0-1. What you are getting is image of S1 will be some connected and compact. So you will get some other closed 0, some A comma B inside closed 0 comma 1. That is a connected compact set. That will be an image of that function under S1. S1 F of S1 will be some compact set inside closed 0 comma 1. That is what you will get from this map. So finally, this result boiled down to be the last result, previous result. So if you answer previous result, same thing will true for here also. There's actually using the connectedness, S1 will be going to some connected subspace of 0 close to 0 comma 1. That is also some interval. Also, it is compact, so that interval should be a compact. So that's why it is boiled down to some closed A comma B inside open closed 0 comma 1. Okay. This you just, if you have answer for true, then you will answer for that one also. So what about these things? There is a homomorphism between alphabet X and X onto A. So if you have some alphabet A, X, given any drawing in your like notebook or something, you can give a topology on that. I mean, you can give a topology with restricted by from R2. Topology from R2 you can give. For that topology, you can argue anything, right? Something like that here also we are doing. So X is some letter. For that, we are giving topology from R2. And A is another letter, we are giving topology from R2. So
sir, what is meant by homomorphism, sir?
Now what you can do is actually three different images. Suppose there is a homomorphism I am assuming and removing some middle point. What I am getting is four different legs. This connected line. But in A, what will happen if you remove some point, you won't get any disconnected thing. If you remove any point, you will get connected thing only. So if you homeomorphism, it is homeomorphism, so you can see it in a reverse way. So what you will get is homeomorphism from reverse way. So A to X, there is no such homeomorphism, because A is, after removing some point also, A is connected, but X is disconnected. So there is a homeomorphism between A and X. There's no homeomorphism between A and X.
So what is meant by homeomorphism and homomorphism, sir? Difference in a sir?
Homomorphism is actually depending on some group structure or something. Here homeomorphism is different actually. Here homeomorphism is about topological property. Preserving topological property and group structure and all is the homomorphism is actually something like studying a structure and group theories. Homeomorphism is actually structure for like preserving structure of topological structure actually.
Thank you, sir.
So I think fifth one also you can try. Like you can try the idea of first question and previous question. Like first question which I have explained, you can try the idea from first question. There is a homomorphism. That is true actually. You just try. I think the time is up. So what should I do? There are some questions, but still, what should I do? Like, ma'am.
Yeah, Salokumar. Do you want 10 more
can
minutes?
Stop or I can take, I mean, I can take, I have many questions. I mean, so it's your wish, ma'am. That's what, like.
They only asked the interaction section to us, okay? Hmm. We have to send the PPT to the WhatsApp group.
Yeah, you can, so, send, I will send you.
Yes, fine. No problem. You can conclude within 5 or 6 minutes. Then we have an interaction section. Okay, Salva Kumar?
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. So these are like some, I have given some questions. So these are some interesting questions. You just check up with the PDF. If you have any doubt, maybe you can maybe directly contact me or something, mail me or something. You can answer that. I can answer that. So these are some questions I have given. You just check. They will forward the PDF to you. Using that PDF, you can check that. Like. Again, I just want to mention, this is the main thing. You have to solve many questions, then only you can, that's why I have given reference again. So like these are some reference, but still main thing is actually you have to solve many questions. That is how you can get many things, like, otherwise you could not get anything, like. So solving questions will be like strengthen you to be a mathematician. So you have to solve many questions. So like, I mean, so what about other things, like, so maybe I will stop here. If you have any doubt in the, like, there are interesting questions still, but you just think about it. If you have any doubt, you can ask maybe tomorrow or something.
Salva Kumar, thank you. Kindly show your face.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Salva.
My face, okay.
Yeah, yes. Okay, participants, very
graphic. Yes, sir.
Hello. Yes, sir. Thank you for your presentation.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Very nice in the presentation. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Participants, is an interaction section for you. We have Dr. Arun Kumar and Mr. Salva Kumar, if you have any doubt, kindly clarify one by one. Unmute your audio and ask one by one. Sir Arun Kumar, sir, kindly be unmuted.
Yes, sir. Okay, madam. Yes. Okay. Thanks, madam.
Participants, if you have doubt, kindly ask one by one.
Sir, explain minimal polynomial.
Yes. So we take a matrix, say it is a 3x3 matrix, okay? And what is the degree of its characteristic polynomial? So do you know what is the degree of the characteristic polynomial?
3.
Yeah. So, and what is the statement of Cayley-Hamilton theorem?
Every square matrix satisfies its own characteristic equation.
Yes. So if you substitute the matrix A in its characteristic polynomial, you will get a 0. Okay. So what we are understanding from this is there is a polynomial of degree 3. If we substitute the matrix A in that polynomial, we will get 0. Okay. So there are polynomials which satisfies the matrix A. Now we are looking at the smallest, least degree polynomial satisfied by A. That is what we call the minimal polynomial. Minimal in the sense, minimal in the degree, which is satisfied by A. So you want to see some examples? Yesterday in my slides, I gave some examples. So maybe just wait, I'll share those slides. Just 1 minute, I made some changes in the file. I have to move. So today I was preparing these notes for quadratic forms, so I made some changes in the file. So that my definition of this minimal polynomial is clear to you. That is a least degree polynomial satisfied by A, and I'll give you some example. So yeah, now I can open this file and show you. Very sorry, I made some changes in the file, so I forced to redo it. This is the file. So about the minimal polynomial. So my presentation is visible?
Yeah, sir, visible. It's visible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Okay. So this is a definition of a minimal polynomial of a matrix. So the least degree polynomial satisfied by A. So this polynomial we denoted by MA of X, and there is one polynomial which is satisfied by A. So if there is a one polynomial, then we can look at the smallest polynomial, smallest degree polynomial satisfied by A. That will be the minimal polynomial. And I think I had some examples. Let's check. So you consider this matrix 0, 1, 0, 0. That is a wrong example. It should be X square. Okay. You consider this matrix 0, 1, 0, 0. And we claim that this polynomial has minimal polynomial X square. So this X minus whole square is wrong. It should be X square. So why this matrix has minimal polynomial X square? Because first, what is the characteristic polynomial of this matrix? So eigenvalues are, it is an upper triangular matrix. So the eigenvalues are diagonal entries. So the diagonal entries are 0, 0. Therefore, eigenvalues, all the eigenvalues are 0. So the characteristic polynomial is X minus 0 into X minus 0, that is X square. And we claim that minimal polynomial is actually equal to the characteristic polynomial. Okay. So what we know is minimal polynomial divides all the polynomial satisfied by A. Okay. So you give me any polynomial, if I substitute A in that polynomial, if I get 0, then minimal polynomial will divide that polynomial also. In particular, minimal polynomial divides characteristic polynomial. Therefore, this matrix has characteristic polynomial X square. So minimal polynomial should be a divisor of X square. Then what are the possible divisors of the polynomial X square? Either it should be X or X square. Okay. Now we'll see. X minimal polynomial of this matrix. So what is the meaning of X is a minimal polynomial? That I'll do now. Okay. Yeah, we can look at this. So we consider this matrix 0, minus 1, 2, 0, for example, and consider the polynomial f of x equal to x square plus 2. What is this polynomial? This is the characteristic polynomial of this matrix. And we substitute A in this matrix. In this polynomial, what is the meaning of substituting a matrix in a polynomial? In place of X, you have to substitute A, and in place of constant term, you have to put constant times identity matrix. Okay, so clearly this is the characteristic polynomial of this matrix, and I'm substituting A, and we are getting 0. Okay, I have calculated A square here for this matrix. A square is this matrix, then A square, actually we are getting minus 2i. And A square is minus 2a, and this is 2a, so we get sum equal to 0. Okay, so this is how we substitute matrix in the polynomials. So this shows that actually matrix satisfies its characteristic polynomial, just Callas theorem. In what I have here I am claiming that so this is my minimal polynomial. We check when the minimal polynomial is a linear polynomial. Okay, suppose minimal polynomial of a matrix is x minus alpha for some scalar alpha. What is the meaning of minimal polynomial is x minus alpha? So minimal polynomial is the least degree polynomial satisfied by A. Therefore, like here, if I substitute A in place of X, I'll get zero, right? Therefore, in place of X, I substitute A. In place of the scalar alpha, I'm substituting alpha times I, like a 2i, like that. So since it is a minimal polynomial, when we substitute A in place of X, we should get zero. That means that A is equal to alpha times I. So what is alpha times I? It's a scalar matrix. It is a diagonal matrix in which all the diagonal entries are alpha. Okay. So the character, the minimal polynomial equal to X minus alpha only if the matrix is a scalar matrix. In particular, in our problem, we were checking when minimal polynomial can be X, right? So in our problem, we are claiming that this matrix has characteristic polynomial X square, and we claim that X square is the minimal polynomial. Therefore, we claim that X is not the minimal polynomial, because minimal polynomial has to divide X square. What are the possible choices of divisors of X square? X into X one choice, and X square is another choice. So we claim that for this matrix, X cannot be minimal polynomial. So here, what we have proved is, suppose X minus alpha is a minimal polynomial, then the matrix has to be alpha times I. In particular, if the minimal polynomial is X, then the matrix has to be zero matrix, because alpha times I, zero times identity is the zero matrix. So the minimal polynomial will be X only if the matrix is the zero polynomial. Okay. So what we have proved is, for some matrix, the polynomial X is a minimal polynomial, means that the matrix has to be zero polynomial. But this matrix is not a zero, the matrix has to be zero matrix. But this matrix is not a zero matrix. Therefore, for this matrix, X cannot be minimal polynomial. Therefore, for this matrix, minimal polynomial has to be X square. Okay. So in general, minimal polynomial is a least degree polynomial satisfied by A. Hello? Is it little clear now what I have said about minimal polynomial?
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
So
anybody?
Jordan canonical form.
With Jordan canonical form. Hello.
Sir, Jordan block and Jordan canonical.
What we are doing in case of diagonalizability? We find the invertible matrix C such that CA C inverse is a diagonal matrix, right? We saw yesterday.
Hello.
Hello.
Ma'am, kindly wait. Tamil Chari, okay. Ma'am, kindly wait. Kindly mute your audio. Sir will come to that.
Okay. Jordan canonical explanation of Jordan canonical form requires some examples. Okay, maybe I'll prepare some examples, and maybe that we will see after the tomorrow session also. Jordan canonical form separately alone. Okay. So, not every matrix can be diagonalized. Okay. So next possible simple form for a matrix is Jordan canonical form. Okay. And yesterday we saw triangulizability also. That is some different form. So we are given an arbitrary matrix, we want to bring into some simple form so that we can do the multiplication and taking powers of the matrix, we can do it easily. Okay. Yeah, so definitely we'll do JCET, Jordan canonical form tomorrow. JCF we'll do first.
So self-adjoint normal matrix and companion matrix.
So self-adjoint means, you know, right, it is A equal to A star, A bar transpose. And yeah, about that, what do you want to know? And companion matrix, you know, right? So suppose you are given a matrix, you know, you can find a polynomial which is satisfied by that matrix. What is that? For example, you can take the characteristic polynomial, right? So now we'll think from the reverse direction. Suppose I give you a polynomial. Can you find a matrix for which this polynomial is the characteristic polynomial? So I give a random matrix, random polynomial. Suppose x cube plus x plus 1. That is my polynomial. How do you find the matrix for which this polynomial is a characteristic polynomial? So this can be answered using companion matrix. So I'll show you the Wikipedia page, actually, companion matrix. So this is the definition of companion matrix. So you start with a monic polynomial. Okay, so this is my monic polynomial. And for this polynomial, I am associating a matrix. So what I am doing, first row n minus, so if it is a n by n, n degree n polynomial, then I have to take n by n matrix. Because if it is a 3 by 3 matrix, then the characteristic polynomial will be degree 3. So if it is a nth degree polynomial, then the matrix will be n by n. So this is a n by n matrix because the polynomial has degree n. And I am first row, I keep it 0 except the last entry. That is my negative of constant. Okay. And this n minus 1 cross n minus 1 block, this block I am taking to be identity matrix. Okay. And I fill the last column to be the negative of the coefficients. Okay. You take it like this. Then you will see that for this matrix, the characteristic polynomial is precisely this polynomial. Okay. So that is what it's. So this is what is called a companion matrix of a polynomial. Okay. Given a polynomial, we can calculate characteristic polynomial. Conversely, given a polynomial, we can find a matrix whose characteristic polynomial is the polynomial we start with. Okay. Yeah. So in the Wikipedia itself, some examples also there. Please check.
Tamil Chelvi ma'am, it's your turn now. Tamil Chelvi ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. Sir? Hi, yes, madam.
Sir, how to write Jordan canonicals by using linear
polynomial? Okay, I will do some examples tomorrow for sure. It requires, I need to make some slides actually. We'll do Jordan canonical form tomorrow for sure actually. So there are some results in the Jordan canonical form that you have to understand clearly. So it requires some eigenspaces and generalized eigenspaces. So that we'll do tomorrow. I'll make some more slides on Jordan canonical form and I'll like explain you those problems.
Okay, yeah. Sir. Ma'am, kindly mute your audio, please. Sir, say then any other participants?
Sir.
Hi, yes, madam.
Sir.
Hi, yes, madam.
Sir, I have one doubt. Diagonalizable over R or C means eigenvalues belongs to R or C. Yes, sir.
No. So that is a again necessary condition, but not sufficient. So maybe I'll show you some. I'll explain it in the slides. I have some slides regarding them. Okay. So for example, consider this matrix 5 2 0 5. Okay, so what are the eigenvalues of this matrix? 5 and 5 5. Okay, so this matrix has all its eigenvalue in the field R, but this matrix is not diagonalizable over R, because if a matrix has all its eigenvalue are equal, then that matrix is not diagonalizable. Okay, so if all the eigenvalues are equal and the matrix is non-diagonal, then the matrix is not diagonalizable. Okay, for example, in this matrix is not diagonalizable, but still all the eigenvalues of this matrix are in R. Okay, so in general, you can take any nilpotent matrices. What are the eigenvalues of nilpotent matrices?
Zero,
right? So zero always in the field, whether R or C, always it will be in the field, underlying field. But nilpotent matrix is diagonalizable only if it is a zero matrix. Zero matrix is a nilpotent matrix, right? If you take the power 1, you will get the again zero matrix. But any non-zero nilpotent matrices are not diagonalizable, okay? So if a matrix, and conversely, so we have to understand two things here. First, suppose if a matrix is diagonalizable, first thing it has to have, suppose matrix is diagonalizable over R. First thing, it has to have eigenvalue in R, okay? If the matrix doesn't have eigenvalue in R, then definitely it is not diagonalizable over R, okay?
Okay.
And I don't know, so again it is a difference between necessary and sufficient condition, but that condition is not sufficient, okay? What could be some nice example to say about necessary and sufficient? Okay, over the talk I'll think a little bit over and I'll let you know. So having an eigenvalue in the underlying field is not sufficient to say the matrix is diagonalizable. We can consider nilpotent matrices.
Okay, so that again won't out. Sir, if suppose we're a given matrix and its characteristic polynomial is lambda cube equal to 1.
Right, okay.
That is, all the eigenvalues are, when we take lambda equal to 1, 1, 1, or when we take lambda equal to 1, omega, omega square.
So it is a 3 by 3 matrix, right?
All the multiplicity, all the same, all the eigenvalues are same. Yes, sir.
If the same 1, 1, 1, then the characteristic polynomial is lambda minus 1 whole cube.
Yes, sir.
Not lambda cube equal to 1. If lambda cube equal to 1, then the eigenvalues are 1 omega omega square. That cube root of infinity. Is that fine?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Kalishwari, kindly unmute your video.
Okay, sir.
Give chances to other participants also. Yeah. Is there any question to Sir Selvakumar, sir?
Sir, a question from me, sir.
To whom?
To Selvakumar, sir. Sir, yes, explain eigenspace, sir.
Meaning? Eigenspace.
Yes.
Okay, actually Arununa is there in that same, I should not explain linear algebra. Okay, so actually eigenspace, eigenspace you can easily, like nicely explained in that book which I have said. There can you refer, like I don't have any slide and all. Arununa, do you have any slide for that?
I'm just checking eigenspace. Whether I have. Yeah, I'm checking whether I have some slides on.
Okay, but if you want to refer eigenspace in that book, Oxler, Linear Algebra of Dendrite, there it has been written very, very nicely, actually. See, during my MSc, I never think about, like, I don't know what is, openly saying in my the beginning courses, I don't understand what is that actually. But once what is the meaning of those everything? But once I see that book, like, those things are very nicely explained. So maybe you can refer that book. So, those are like invariant subspaces. Those things are playing main role. So, invariant subspaces, we never study invariant subspaces. We have to study invariant subspaces. What is the meaning of that? Using that, you can see eigenspaces. You just refer invariant subspaces. So maybe Arununa will explain now. Otherwise, maybe we have to prepare and.
Can you see my slides?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I have this one example. Maybe I'll explain you this.
I think it's a collection of eigenvectors associated with each value. I think so.
Yes. Well, that is the correct definition of eigenvectors.
Yeah.
So my screen is visible now. I have shared my screen, right?
Yeah, visible.
Okay, so in this problem, which of the following matrix is not diagonalizable over R? Okay, so this is the problem. And so if you look at this matrix, they have distinct eigenvalues. So definitely this is diagonalizable over R. So in the again, this matrix also has distinct eigenvalues, so it is diagonalizable over R. So when we, if we look at these two matrices, and here eigenvalue 2 repeated twice, and here also eigenvalue 2 repeated twice. So that's what we call algebraic multiplicity. Okay, and so algebraic multiplicity of the eigenvalue 1 is 2, and algebraic multiplicity of the eigenvalue 2 is 1, because it occurs once, this occurs twice. Okay, so given such a matrix, how do one check whether the matrix is diagonalizable or not? So we check the corresponding eigenspace, and the dimension of the eigenspace is what we call geometric multiplicity. Okay, so we will calculate the dimension of the one eigenspace. Eigenspace corresponds to the eigenvalue 1. So what is, so I have written this equation, Ax equal to lambda x. Here lambda is 1, therefore I have written just Ax equal to x. And using this condition, I am finding the values of x1, x2, x3. Okay, so set of all possible values of this x1, x2, x3, that will give me the eigenspace corresponds to the eigenvalue 1. Okay, so now I multiply left hand side and I equate with the right hand side. So 1 times x1 plus 1 times x2 equal to this x1. Then 0 times x1 plus 2 times x2 plus 0 times x3 is 2x2 equal to x2. This one is 0 times x1, 0 times x2 plus 1 times x3 equal to this right side x3. Okay, so 2x2 equal to x2 means that x2 is 0. Okay, if you substitute the value x2 equal to 0, you get x1 equal to x1. So that we are not getting any condition. And again, x3 equal to x3. That also we are not getting any condition. X1 equal to x1 is always true, whatever is x1. X3 equal to x3 is not such a big condition. So only condition we are getting is x2 equal to 0. So when arbitrary x1, x2, x3 satisfies this condition, only when x2 equal to 0. So set of all x1, 0, x3, such that x2 becomes 0, so we don't need to include x1 here. X1, x3 belongs to R. So this is the eigenspace corresponds to the eigenvalue 1. Okay. And therefore, what is the dimension of this vector subspace of R3? There are two independent variables. Therefore, dimension is 2. Okay. So this 2 is what we call the geometric multiplicity of the eigenvalue 1. So already clearly algebraic multiplicity is 2 because 2 has appeared twice. Okay. Therefore, for the eigenvalue 1, geometric multiplicity equal to algebraic multiplicity. And so this we have to do, check for all the eigenvalues to check the diagonalizability of a matrix. So what is the other eigenvalue? That is 2. So this 2 appear only once. So if an eigenvalue occurs only once, you don't need to check whether geometric multiplicity equal to algebraic multiplicity, it always be equal. Okay, therefore the other eigenvalue is also, you have geometric multiplicity equal to algebraic multiplicity, therefore this matrix is diagonalizable. Okay, so you need to know, I mean, this eigen, as Selokumar said, eigen spaces are very important concept to talk about diagonalizability and all. Okay, so this is one example of diagonalizability or eigenspace of a matrix. And using the same idea, you can check whether this matrix is diagonalizable or not. Again, for this matrix, you check the, do the same calculation and find the dimension of the space. If this dimension of the space is again 2, then this matrix is diagonalizable. If not, this matrix is not diagonalizable. So it is a part C problem. So more than one option. Already we said all the A, B, D, all these matrices are diagonalizable. So C, you check whether it is diagonalizable or not. So eigenspace is clear little bit?
I think it is clear. Yes,
sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, welcome.
N minus rank of A minus lambda I polama, sir. Eigenspace kandupidikkathukku.
Sir, N minus rank of
A minus lambda I.
N minus rank of A minus I.
Lambda I.
Why?
Geometric multiplicity kandupidikkathukku appadi kandupidikkalama sir.
Just a moment, let me write also. So what you are saying, N minus
rank of
a
minus lambda I.
Oh, okay, N minus, okay, you are saying like this. Okay, I so you want to find the geometric multiplicity of lambda.
Yes, sir. This is the nullity of A minus lambda I.
Okay, wait. Right. Okay. So from rank nullity theorem, it just follows, right? So, so geometric multiplicity of lambda is equal to nullity of A minus lambda I, that is equal to n minus rank of A minus lambda I. Yes, that is correct. Yeah, you can take it like this. Yes. So thank what you. That is correct. Yeah, but it is not, I mean, computationally it is not easy. Why are you going to calculate the rank? Always calculating the image is difficult. Always it is easy to calculate the kernel. Okay
sir.
So better to calculate the method I told you, that might be very easy.
Yes, sir. How to identify similarity matrices, sir?
So first check whether a trace is same.
Okay.
And then, I mean, like there are many properties that are preserved by similar matrices, right? So.
Okay, sir. They are given three matrices.
Huh.
A, B. The diagonals are zero.
Okay. Huh.
Its determinant is also zero. For all the three matrices, determinants are zero.
Okay.
But diagonals are zero.
For that,
I thought when you for the similarity matrix, if you wanted, we have to find a we can able to find a inverse matrices. There exists a P inverse and there is a P matrix, which should be an invertible one.
Okay, is so all the matrices are given 2x2 matrix?
It's a 3x3 matrices.
So if it is 3x3 matrix, then finding that P may be a little difficult. I mean, it is a time consuming, I'm saying. If it exam, finding P is there.
Okay. My question is, if it is a 3x3 matrices, all the eigenvalues are 0, 0, we cannot find out the invertible matrix for that.
No. I mean, that in existence of that P has nothing to do with the eigenvalue of that matrix.
Okay. It's a any matrix. We can take up identity matrix also. Identity matrix is a trivial thing, is it?
No. So, I mean, it like you take two different matrix, okay?
Okay.
And all the diagonal entries are zero.
Okay.
Then identity matrix cannot conjugate, right? If you multiply by identity and identity inverse, you'll get back the same matrix. So you cannot get a different matrix. So you cannot use identity in place of C.
Okay.
But what you can do is, so actually this problem depends very much on the matrix, which matrix is given actually. Is there any way how to see that matrix?
Sir, Arun sir, I have posted the question in the group and the explanation, I have given the explanation also. I'll post the question. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. It's you said on the depends upon the determinant.
WhatsApp group, ma'am.
I'll write
the correct explanation, full explanation to that problem. Okay, ma'am? Then only it will be clear. Okay. I think.
Excuse me, sir.
Sir,
when we mean by triangularizable of a matrix, like if we say our matrix A is triangularizable over some field F. So that means the linear factors are in that field F.
Yes. That is correct.
So if we have a matrix A that is triangularizable over R, so the linear factors are in R. So if the linear factors are in R, then that means that the linear factors are in C also. So does that mean that the matrix is triangularizable over C?
Sure. triangularizable, yes, triangularizable over R implies triangularizable over C. That is just from the definition. Because, so suppose the matrix is triangularizable over R, okay? You find a matrix C such that C inverse is a triangular matrix, right? That is C, what you get, it is a real matrix that you can consider as a complex matrix also, because every real matrix is a complex matrix, right? Every real number is a complex number. Okay. Therefore, if a matrix is triangularizable over R, then it is triangularizable over C. Okay, but the converse is not true. And over C, every matrix is triangularizable.
So if it is...
If it is?
Oh. Yes,
no.
I got
that it. If it is? Okay. Okay. Hello.
Sir, you said a matrix is diagonalizable over R, then its eigenvalues are also in R. It is true for any field?
Any field. It's true for any field. So that is a necessary condition. Okay. So you are given a matrix and you have to check whether that matrix is diagonalizable over a field F. First step, you have to check whether the eigenvalues are lying in that field. Okay. For example, we saw that matrix, right? 0, minus 1, 1, 0. Its characteristic polynomial is x square plus 1. So the eigenvalues are plus or minus 5. So that matrix is definitely not diagonalizable over R because the eigenvalues are not in the underlying field. Okay. So I'll just explain the same in my slide actually. This one everybody has to know. Some simple fact, but okay. All these things are in the slide that I shared with you yesterday. So please have a look at it. Okay. Yes. So what is the definition of diagonalizable matrices? Yeah, let A be n by n matrix with eigenvalues lambda 1 through lambda n. A is said to be diagonalizable over a field F if there exists an invertible matrix P that is also over F. Therefore, the entries of P are the elements of F such that P A P inverse equal to diagonal lambda 1, etc. lambda n. Right. Now, A is a matrix over the field F. This is a matrix over the field F. P is again a matrix over the field F. Therefore, P inverse also a matrix over a field F. This means that this product, it's a matrix over the field F, right? Therefore, left-hand side is a matrix over the field F. So, right-hand side is also has to be a matrix over the same field F. But this is a diagonal matrix. So, this is a matrix over the field F means that all these diagonal entries has to be in the field F. Okay?
Okay.
So that means that if you diagonalize, the first condition is the eigenvalue should be in the underlying field. For example, this matrix cannot be diagonalized over R because its eigenvalue is plus or minus I. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Sarun, sir, I think it's enough because it has gone to more than nearly 3 hours. Okay, sir. Is there any questions? We will also discuss in tomorrow's session also. Okay, Arun. Sir, hello, sir. Arun, sir. Hello. Hello. Okay. Now I'd like to call Dr. J. Kannan to deliver a formal vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, to honorable person here. Okay. It's my pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks in this favorable occasion. First of all, I thank our management and principal for encouraging us to conduct a program like this. Next, I thank our conveners for giving their full support to organize this program. Then I thank today resource person Mr. A. Sellokumar, research scholar IIT Madras, Chennai, for kindly accepting our invitation and making today's session continuity and differentiation a great success. I thank him for the way he carried out the session. Next, I thank our organizing secretary for organizing this program in an efficient manner. Next, I thank my colleagues for their kind cooperation for this program. Finally, I thank all the participants for maintaining patience and their great involvement will make this program a success one. Once again, I thank you all.
Thank you, Kannan sir. Sir, Parveen Suren sir, shall we conclude the meeting, sir?
Sure. Okay, ma'am. Sir. We can conclude. Okay. Arun Kumar, hello, sir.
Yes.
Arun Kumar and Salok Kumar, sir.
Yes, sir. Hello. Yes, sir.
Arun Kumar, sir. Thank you for both for your
thank you, sir.
Presentation and first session.
Okay. Arun, okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Arun Kumar. Hello.
I think
Arun Kumar is there.
Maybe he's
Arun Kumar is not in the line, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Maybe he left.
Okay. We will see next tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you, both of them.
Thank
if you are free, kindly join with us tomorrow's session also.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Alafi. Okay. Participants, today's attendance link posted in the chat box. Kindly fill it before 1:30. And today's handout and the content given by Mr. Selvakumar also will post in WhatsApp group before 1:30. Today also we have a quiz. The quiz question will be posted through WhatsApp group at sharply 5 p.m. Have a good day. Thank you.